make sure to follow us on Instagram at Whistlethrowers. It's a great way to interact with our show. Our DMs are always open for questions, topic discussions, and more. You will be able to find our new episodes and other announcements there.
Brock Purdy, ever since I said I didn't know when he's going to lose a game, he lost two back to back. Thanks for tuning back into the Whistlethrowers podcast. This is Jack LaVar, joined by
Jack Slater.
And we got the conference finals championship going on right now. So yesterday, the Astros lost in game seven in a blowout to the Rangers. So initial thoughts on that?
Yeah, here's a wild stat for you guys. In their last 28 home games of the season, the Houston Astros were 7-21. I mean, that's like just a wild stat for a team that has dominated at home for nearly a decade. Dusty Baker hasn't had great history in game sevens, but I mean, it's just really, even with their managerial shortcomings, I still felt like this team was good enough to do more than what they did. I feel like this is just a disappointment for them.
Yeah, I didn't really understand what Dusty Baker said, that this was a successful season. It's not at all.
Right.
I mean, you struggled so much at home throughout the entire regular season. The only real success they had in any stadium was against the Rangers in Arlington.
Yeah.
That was it.
Mm-hmm.
So it made sense that they won those two games. The fact that you only had to win one game at home and couldn't do it, that's just... it's disrespectful to your fans, number one. Mm-hmm. All that money to see you play at home, and you like just play that badly. Number two, it's just like disgraceful as a baseball organization. You can't win one game at home.
Yeah.
And I understand it's just as bad as the Rangers, but at least the Rangers were able to pull out four away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the fact they were 8-0 on the road, which is just also insane.
Yeah, right.
So I think that when you look back at this series, you're going to see that the Astros had so many chances to win, just couldn't do it.
Yeah.
Anything, the Rangers controlled the series outside of allowing a couple late home runs to Altuve. They could have wrapped this up way more or way quicker than seven games. So to me, they just dominated the series, and the Astros just looked flat.
Yeah, I agree with you in that sense, because like if the series was won by who won the inning, like the Rangers would have swept them. I mean, it felt like the Astros were winning about like an inning or two at a time, even in their wins, you know, so... for them to keep it that close, I mean, I was pretty surprised, because that usually does, like, it's usually not sustainable for a seven game series. Like, yeah, you can win a game and maybe sneak in another, but winning three games that way is really, like, just, it's sort in some ways an anomaly. Like, it's not incredibly rare, but it is rare. So I was surprised. Yeah. I was surprised, but you got to give credit to the Texas Rangers. I mean, they're a way better team than I thought coming in. Like, To be honest, I picked Tampa Bay over them in the wild card. I really didn't expect Texas to get this far, but they've shown a lot. I mean, they're deep everywhere. Yeah. They're deep.
I mean, the Rangers were also only a game away from having the second seed.
Yep.
Like, so they were a really, really good team. People just underestimate them because they weren't playing Tampa Bay. The one thing that worries me is that Max Scherzer just hasn't looked good in his two starts.
Right.
And, I mean, they pulled him almost immediately after he gave up those two runs last night, and that's one of the reasons why they won the game. But if he doesn't play better, then they're going to be in trouble, because Nathan Lowe can only pitch so well for so long. I mean, he could do it throughout the preseason, through the World Series. Like, it's entirely possible.
Yeah.
But you want to have a deep rotation this late in the season. And I just don't know if the Rangers have that to the extent that we thought they did going into the playoffs.
Yeah, definitely. And I was impressed by their bullpen for the most part. They had a couple hiccups, but I mean, you're gonna see that this late in the postseason. Yeah. Like, you're just not always gonna allow one run. I mean, or else you'd sweep every time. So,
Chapman also is the setup man has been great.
Right. Yeah. Uh huh. Yeah. I mean, and it's like they're getting these big contributions from guys that you didn't know before the season. And I know that is the case with most bullpens anyway, but like, keep going.
When you look at the Astros bullpen, the guys that they have, like, you have Phil Maton, who's pitched a while.
Yep.
You've got Hector Neris, who's got experience. Like, they have got a deep bullpen. When you look at the Rangers, they really don't have that sort of deepness in guys that you were expecting going into the playoffs to step up the way they have.
Yeah.
I know that Leclerc has really struggled down the stretch. But to me, I still feel pretty confident with him as my closer, and Chapman as eight. Especially if you can have Chapman
Yeah.
That's what they're thinking, and that's where they're at right now. I think that they can easily win. It doesn't really matter who they play. I think that I still think that whoever they play, it will be a deep series, but I can see the Rangers being favorites going in.
Definitely, definitely. And especially with the home field advantage, like when you start talking betting, I definitely could see them as like not a heavy favorite, but the favorite.
No, definitely not heavy, but I could see them as most people picking them to win.
Yeah.
So my question as a baseball outsider is, why do they get the home field advantage when the two teams in the NL have the same record as them?
So it goes by record, and then it goes by head-to-head. So the Phillies lost.
Oh, yeah. We played them opening week, right?
Yeah.
They got crushed.
Yeah.
Right.
I think the first game was 16-3, so yeah, it was... Yeah. I mean, again, first series of the season is not telling about what's going to happen. And it is crazy now because in baseball, it used to be that you could take a series off and still be okay. Now you really can't.
Yeah.
Because it can come back to hurt you when you don't even think about it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm sure not many people thought that the Rangers and Phillies or Rangers and Diamondbacks would be playing each other in the World Series, but that's where we're at right now.
Yeah, and I feel like you see this parody most in the MLB where, like, You wouldn't even have thought the Diamondbacks would be in the championship series, much less a game 7 in it and knocking on the door. So there's always that parity. Like, the Phillies were that team last year, you know?
As we're recording, we're watching the Phillies game right now. It is the fifth inning right now.
Yeah, top of the fifth. Yeah. Corbin Carroll just tied up the game with a single, 2-2.
And did they retire the side? Or?
No.
Rangers coming out. I can't see from...
Yeah, sorry, no. Two outs in the... In the top of the fifth, 2-2 game, Phillies just pulled Rangers.
Yeah, me and Slay were saying that this game was over in the first inning, but they're fighting. I mean, Alec Bohm came alive at the best moment possible so far.
Yeah, the only fear I have right now of Philadelphia is one of their weaknesses is leaving men in scoring position.
Yeah.
And they're doing it right now. They've left a couple runners in scoring position already so far tonight, and... In a game that's, again, really tight, like, those are the runs you need. Those are the hits you need. And
the issue for me, though, is that they're leaving guys on base late in their lineup. And the issue is I don't see them taking guys out for offensive purposes when it would totally hurt their defense. Like, I know Rojas struck out with the bases loaded, but you can't take him out of the lineup solely because he's such a great defender.
Yeah, right.
And, I mean, you could pinch in for Jake Cave, maybe. But then, I mean, it's way too early to be thinking like that because you don't want that to come back to hurt you in a defensive situation.
Yeah.
So they're in a tough position because of that, but I'm not too worried about leaving them on base bat. And when you're in, like, the nine hole, I'm more worried about guys that aren't getting hits that were before. Castellanos has looked so off this
year. Yeah, right, yeah.
Outside the one home run. Mm-hmm. Bohm finally came alive, but he looked off. Turner's been struggling as well. So there's these guys that you paid to win you in this situation, and they're not coming through. That concerns me more than leaving the bases loaded with Rojas batting.
Yeah, and I saw a stat also today. In the 8 wins this postseason, Harper is hitting like 400-something, with, you know, just ridiculous numbers. And then in their 4 losses, he's hitting 083. Yeah, so, I mean, the Phillies need their stars to come up right now. Like, if the Phillies get their star production, they're going to win. But if they don't, they're just leaving the door open for Arizona.
Yeah, we can move into the NFL now. Mm-hmm. It's easy to start with the Vikings-Niners game because Brock Purdy, ever since I said I didn't know when he's going to lose a game, he lost 2 back-to-back.
Yeah.
And I'm not even going to pin, like, the Browns game on him because he did put them in the position to win. It's just the kicker took them out.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like Jake Moody's struggling still, so that might be huge for them down the line.
Yeah, definitely.
But they aren't healthy as a squad, and, like, it kind of looks like Brock Purdy, like, needs his systematic, like, super team offense to, like, get them to beat, like, even 2-4 squads, which is kind of concerning because they're missing Justin Jefferson still and for the next 2 or 3 games as well, so...
Mm-hmm. That's where most of my concern would lie right now with San Fran, is that your defense struggled so badly against, you know, we've actually been saying it all year, but the Vikings offense is not bad by any stretch of the imagination. I'd actually say they're even above average.
Oh, yeah. Besides a run game.
Yeah. But even without Jefferson, like, I think Kirk Cousins is a solid, good quarterback. in this league. And sorry, a little bit distracted. The Diamondbacks just took the lead, but
this game's gonna be a dog.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, it is.
The Vikings were really putting the pressure on San Fran, and they couldn't get off the field. Kirk Cousins, I believe, was 8-for-13 on third downs. I mean, you're not going to win most games when you can't get off the field on third down.
Yeah, I 100% agree with that. The Vikings definitely outplayed the Niners. The Niners just fell totally flat, and Kirk Cousins definitely has stepped up.
Yeah.
But I will say, the one guy that's not getting any credit for this is Kevin O'Connell. Like, this is what I said last year, is that when he came from the Rams, he was going to change the Vikings' offense and make them so much better. It happened last year. They got off to a slow start this year, and everyone started saying, oh, maybe we should move on from him. Well, now they just beat one of the best defenses in the NFL. So when is this guy going to get the credit that he deserves for turning the Vikings around from an offense that was sputtering for the last 5 years to one of the better offenses in the NFL?
Yeah.
Because it's going to come soon.
Mm-hmm. I also found it really interesting that the Vikings don't have a rushing touchdown, or they didn't through week six.
And they got one last night?
I'm not too sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure either.
But even then, 6 weeks without a rushing touchdown is insane.
Definitely.
Like, if you shut down the pass, I mean, I don't have expectations for them, like, moving forward, but, like, that's alarming. It kind of makes me wonder why you cut Dalvin Cook.
Yeah, me too. And, like, going into this year, I thought I was saying the Vikings' run game was really leaned on by their O-line. They just haven't got that type of O-line play to have a good running game and, like, have a consistent running attack. And, yeah, I mean, Dalvin Cook isn't really anything special anymore, but Madison is a noticeable drop-off from him. That's sure.
I will say, I haven't noticed a drop-off in average. They're just not rushing for touchdowns.
Yeah.
So, I mean, all of their guys are averaging 4 yards or more per carry. So, it's not like that they can't run the ball. It's just that it seems like they're refusing to in red zone situations, which to me is just bizarre. Because I feel like Madison could do it. Cam Akers absolutely could be a red zone threat. We saw him do it in Los Angeles at the backup running back. So, I don't know why you don't use Akers in that situation. Like, to me, that makes no sense.
Yeah. We can move into the Bills-Patriots game. So, my question is to you guys. Are the Bills just not, are they frauds, or is it that the Patriots are just, they made it through the rough stretch and they're going to start playing way better than they did? Because they kind of do look like a different team now. Like, Ramondre Stevenson is actually producing in the way we thought he was going to, and Mac Jones had a game-winning drive, and we all thought, like, he was going to get benched for Malik Cunningham.
I know, he was, Mac Jones was on the verge of losing his job, and he's been playing better the last 2 weeks, I'd say, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's been playing better. He's been playing himself back into a solidified role. I don't know. Again, I don't know if it's sustainable. I don't know if that's going to be the consistent level of play for them. But you do have the head coach to do that, to, like, maintain that level of play, or at least something close to it. So, I don't think the Patriots will be as bad as we thought, you know, when they lost 38-0 or whatever to Dallas and lost to the Saints right after that by 30. Like, I don't think they'll be that bad, but I also don't think that they're going to sniff a playoff spot. Like,
no.
I just see them as, like, a 5-6 win team, and it's kind of just, like, you're not bad enough for the first pick, and you're not good enough to knock on the door of the playoffs. It's just not a great spot to be.
Yeah. I will say, someone told me that Josh Allen mimics whoever he's playing against at quarterback, and I can't argue that. Like, I don't know what's up with him. He was like, he has an amazing offense, but, like, the Bills lose. Like, they don't, like, get outplayed by their performance. Like, they just don't play to the standard that they should be.
Yeah, they play down to their opponent. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Here's something that's absolutely wild. So after the first loss to the Jets, which was just a weird game, the Bills scored over 30 points in the next three, absolute blowouts. And then the last three, they scored under 30 points. And actually, they scored under 25 or under in all three. 20 against Jacksonville, 14 against the Giants, 25 against the Patriots. Like, their offense has just fallen off noticeably, and it's a problem. And I don't know what the issue is, because it's not like there's guys that are, like,
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what the issue is, but they got to figure it out, because at this point, they're just looking like a 500 team, and yeah, you can get into the wild card with that, but to me, they're not nearly the threat that we thought they were last year.
Definitely, definitely, definitely. And, like, it's clear that the Dolphins have surpassed them, like, even though they lost and didn't look too good on Sunday night. Like, the Dolphins are still, I think, clearly the better team. And it's okay, like, it's okay to have a hiccup like that against the Eagles, you know. But for the Bills, like, against Jacksonville and New England this week, like, those are teams you just can't have hiccups against. Like, you need to beat the inferior opponents to you. And not saying Jacksonville's bad, but they're inferior to Buffalo. That's the matter of fact.
Yeah.
I do want to move into the Browns-Colts game. So there's been a lot of shifting at quarterback for the Browns. Deshaun Watson went out really early in the game, and then P.J. Walker took the reins. But yeah, it was a nail-biter the whole way through. Like, Gardner Minshew played well, but they just couldn't keep up with the Browns' defense.
Yeah.
Which sounds weird, because, like, Gardner threw for over 300 yards and 2 touchdowns. And they got a lot of help from John Taylor. Josh Downs at a 125-yard game. I think the Browns are, like, the sneaky team in the AFC. And, like, their defense could really carry them into, like, a wild card playoff spot. And I don't know. Maybe they can knock out a team in the wild card round.
Yeah, it's definitely possible. Like, I think when you get to January, having a defense like that is I feel like that is a recipe for success, you know, in an opening round. You know, obviously when you hit the Kansas City Chiefs and those AFC teams, like, you're not going to be able to win like that. Like, you need your offense to do something. And I don't know if they have the offense to really compete. But yeah, I agree with you that they have the defense to upset someone, you know, and, like, give their offense good opportunities in a single game, you know. I think they have that opportunity, yeah.
Aiden, you got anything else?
I totally agree. I think they could be a playoff team. The biggest thing to me is they just got to be a little bit more consistent. You're talking about their defense. They did play well against San Francisco, and they played well in other games as well. But they have 38 to guard against them in the Colts.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I understand that you had your backup quarterback in, so that totally changes that factor of the game. But I don't know, like, I feel like their defense could do it. But like I said, you gotta be more consistent than that. And it will be interesting seeing some of the opponents they have coming up in Baltimore and Seattle, which is two of their next three games, because those are two pretty good offenses.
Yeah.
Yeah, we should. Great,
but I think we could easily say both those offenses are better than the Colts.
Oh, yeah.
So I think that they need to step it up in those games, and then we can talk about whether or not they're a playoff team. Uh-huh. So I think those two games will be very telling.
Agreed.
This is a good transition in the Lions-Ravens game. So, obviously, the Lions got blown out. So, is this more of Lamar is, like, really coming out into his midseason form? Or is this they beat up on a Lions team that doesn't have their running back?
Nah, I think this is the Lamar Jackson that we know. I've always been a Lamar Jackson guy. You know, he's had ups and downs, like, I think he peaked a lot in his MVP year, and then, like, he hasn't hit that level again, but he's still at an elite quarterback level. And I think when he's playing like that, the Ravens are a really good team. And right now, they're probably a top five team. You know, I think that they've shown a little bit more consistency than other teams. And, like, although that's flown under the radar, I feel like, a little bit, because I just don't think they're one of the more talked about teams. I think that they are slept on a little bit. And
yeah.
I think when you're getting this level of play from guys like Roquan Smith on your line, like, that's, I love that brand of defense, is like when your edge rusher is really your anchor. Like, that's the guy you lean on. I think that's a really good place to be.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we need to start giving Lamar a lot more credit, especially when you consider that they've lost J.K. Dobbins for the season. They're down Keaton Mitchell as well. So you got Gus Edwards and Justin Sills, your running backs.
Mm-hmm.
And Zay Flowers is a rookie as your number one receiver. So the fact that they've been this good with that type of offense, and most of it's just because of Lamar, that just shows how good of a quarterback he is and why the Ravens made the right choice in giving him the contract that they did. Now, he played great in every a whole lot of other competition outside the Ravens. The Steelers have played really well somehow, despite Matt Kansas' play calling.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I do think that the Ravens at this point is their division to lose. And if they keep playing this way, they'll easily win.
Oh, yeah. It's going to be really competitive, though. Like, there's there's a 5-2 team, there's 2-4-2 teams, and the Bengals are knocking at the door. They're, what, 3-3, 4-3 now? Or 3-4 now? So, and obviously they're like playing way better than they did the first 4 weeks, so it's going to be a dogfight for the AFC North.
Yeah, I mean, it might come down to that Steelers game at the end of the season.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
For the division winner, which I don't think many people would have thought, considering that it was supposed to be the Bengals, but just because they got off to such a slow start, and they're obviously playing better, but it gives them way less opportunities to slip up than the Ravens have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, like, I feel like the Steelers under Mike Tomlin have all, like, they have these years where you're just, they're not super talented, and, like, they just don't really look good on paper, and you're just waiting for them to fall off a cliff, and they just never fall off the cliff. Like, he's such a good coach.
Really, again, the play calling for the Steelers has not been good.
It's been terrible.
It's been getting a little bit better, but still, it shouldn't be. It's not good enough that they should be 4-2, and yet they still are.
Yeah.
And that's a testament, like you said, to Mike Tomlin's coaching rather than the way that the offense is played.
Definitely.
Yeah. I do want to talk about the Falcons-Buccaneers game because I do want to go on a rant with Bijan Robinson. You guys know I have him in 3 out of 4 leagues, and yeah, it was not a good week, but I'm calling for Arthur Smith to be fired immediately. I'm surprised he didn't. He hasn't been canned already. Like, I understand, like, if Bijan's sick, but, like, say he's sick. Like, the reason you don't play him is he's not feeling himself. Like, what the hell does that mean? Mm-hmm. Like, what does that mean? Like, Tyler Allgeier, 21 carries, 59 yards. You need Robinson. You drafted him in the top 10, and you're not using him because he's not feeling well. Mm-hmm. Like, or himself. Like, what does that even mean?
Yeah,
like, they did not deserve to win this game. Desmond Ridder looks terrible still.
Yeah.
And they have one of the best kickers in the league, but he didn't look like it because Desmond Ridder hasn't been able to get him in positions where he's able to kick the ball. Because you see, the week before, he'll take him to the red zone, and then he'll throw a pick, and then it's, like, rinse and repeat. Like, this is the worst team to have fantasy players on. Mm-hmm. Like,
oh, believe me, I know. I'm a Kyle Pitts owner right now.
It's yeah.
Very sad.
Very. Like, he did have a good week, not today, but last week.
But he still only had, like, 14 points.
Yeah, that's really good for fantasy. But I want to see Heinicke really bad. I want to see Arthur Smith collecting unemployment next week. It makes no sense. Like, you could get a haul trading either one of those running backs. Get rid of Bijan, please. Give him to a team like, I don't know, the Vikings. Imagine him on the Vikings.
Realistically, you know they can't do that.
No, get rid of Allgeier then. Like, you don't need both of them.
Well, I mean, look at the Lions there. They've basically done the same thing with Montgomery and Gibbs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yeah.
I don't know what it is about them not trusting these high draft picks. I mean, for the Lions, it's worked out pretty well because Montgomery, I mean, is so much better than Allgeier. But I really don't get the idea of using two running backs if you're going to have a high draft pick for running back.
Mm-hmm.
And then sign another in free agency. Or just already have them on the roster and not play the guy that you drafted. Like, to me, that's just a waste of a pick at that point.
Yeah. And honestly, this, like, feeds the agenda of don't pay running backs and don't draft running backs high. It's like, you drafted this guy top 10, and he's not even necessarily fitting in your scheme. And it's like, he doesn't play an impactful position. He just doesn't. Like, I like running backs. Running backs are important in certain roles, but it's not a quarterback. It's not a wide receiver. It's not a left tackle. Like, it's...
Yeah, let me say this. The position is important, but I don't think it's important which guy plays that position.
Yeah, that's a really good way to put it. Yeah, because, I mean, Boston Scott is a great example of this. Like, he puts up good production. But, and I mean, obviously he's not good enough to be the number one back anywhere at any time. But, like, you still get good production out of him. And it's like, that's why you don't need to pay a running back $15 million, is because you pay Boston Scott $1 million, and he does well.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it, remember when Ty Montgomery got put in as a running back going from wide receiver, and it looked fine for the Packers and Ravens?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It looked great, actually.
You can literally, to me, put in any position player at running back, mm-hmm. and if they're athletic, they'll see the NFL, they're athletic enough to be a running back.
Yeah.
But this...
So, I'm not saying that running backs don't deserve to get paid, because certain ones do. I think Saquon absolutely does, especially if he can stay healthy. Austin Eckler is an absolute game changer for the Chargers when he's healthy.
Mm-hmm.
So there is guys that I would pay, but I'm not going out and signing Dalvin Cook to a massive contract as he's getting closer to 30 and going instead for like a younger running back. Like that's what I would do,
yeah.
rather than pay a guy like Cook or one of these older veterans.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't get it though, especially with the Falcons, because like Bijan's a great receiving back. Like oh, yeah. he's a great receiving back. He's dynamic. He could do everything, and he's a better rusher than Algier. But like, oh, yeah. you're not giving him either or. Like, I would prefer it for fantasy purposes if he's the receiving back. Like that would be awesome. But like, no, you just want to run Tyler Algier and just have Bijan as like a decoy, even though like. He makes guys miss, and he's played 7 games. Like
yeah.
Six and a half.
Yeah, right. And, like, that's, like, what I was getting at earlier with the scheme, too, was, like, you, like, why isn't he fitting in your scheme? Like, mm-hmm. your scheme should be around Bijan Robinson or yeah. any of the players you draft top 10.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that, I'm sorry, you know, when you're the Falcons in that situation, like, you need a guy to come in right now and perform, and he needs to be cheap.
Two red zone threats in Robinson and
Pitts.
Yeah. So you've got those two guys as options.
Yeah.
And you just refuse to use them and are relying on Desmond Ridder to like get other guys involved who
yeah.
just doesn't seem like he's the type of quarterback that's going to be a starter for that long. I can see him as a backup. Like mm-hmm. I think he's a fine backup. But I just don't know if you can build a franchise around him.
No.
And it seems
no.
like they have other pieces where if you put in a quarterback who could be a franchise guy, and they'll be a successful team, but they're just not there right now.
Yeah.
And I think the biggest thing that's holding back is Desmond Ridder.
Yeah.
And I'm just seeing this right now. Patriots have cut Malik Cunningham.
Wow.
Just after signing him. So that's a really bipolar move, if you ask me. Like, Mac Jones is one game winning drive, and you're like, nope, this is the franchise. Like,
yeah.
That makes zero sense to me. Like, what are you going to do if he starts playing, like, the first 5 weeks of the season? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that doesn't make much sense.
I mean, let's be real, though. It's not like Cunningham, like, yeah. you throw them in, they're much better.
No, but it's some insurance.
Yeah, it's some. My guess is that maybe they're looking at getting another quarterback with the trade deadline coming up.
Yeah.
That would be my only thought. That would make sense.
Yeah.
Because you're right, it doesn't make sense in the sense that you have another guy to, like, fill in. But I feel like Belichick's got to be looking for game changer. Although Mac Jones didn't play better than he's played before. You're right. He didn't look great the first 5 games.
Yeah.
And if I'm the Patriots, I'm not relying too much on the back of quarterbacks that I have. So I'm really going out in the market and trying to trade for a guy.
Mm-hmm. We can move into the Chargers-Chiefs game. So Patrick Mahomes, this is the first game all season where he looked like his normal self.
Yeah.
Like, and this was a highly anticipated matchup. For some reason, every year, everyone thinks the Chargers have a chance of winning the division. When in my mind, they never had that chance, really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Justin Herbert did not play a good game again. He doesn't really look like the guy that everyone says he was going to be the last however many years.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, if you're the Chargers, you're 2-4. Justin Herbert is throwing 259 yards, 1 touchdown, 2 picks.
Yeah.
40 dropbacks, 5 sacks. Like, mm-hmm. you have talent here, but it's clearly not enough.
Yeah, and, like, the thing is, despite the scoreboard, I think the Chargers' defense, like, I think they somewhat did enough to keep them in the game. Like, because that's the thing. Like, you're not going to stop Mahomes. Like, you're not holding them under 20. You're not – none of that. But I felt like the Chargers' defense was, like, spotting their victories. Like, they were – winning, like, certain plays that had a chance to, like, shift momentum. And the Chargers offense was just not getting it done at all. And, like, this is kind of a weird comparison. It reminded me a lot of the Ohio State-Penn State game that happened on Saturday. It was, like, Penn State's defense was just doing everything they could granted, they played a lot better than the Chargers defense did, but they in theory, they were doing everything they could, giving the offense opportunities, and the offense was just squandering them in, like pathetic ways. Like, it just, it looked pathetic. Like, it, that game in the first quarter, I was like, I don't see the Chargers winning this unless they turn it around, like, big time. It just, the whole time, it felt like the Chargers were feeble and, like, they couldn't move the ball if they wanted to.
Yeah. And on that Penn State game, that was really low scoring. Like, that's telling for the defense.
Yeah, but yeah.
I loved how everyone was saying, oh, this is the year Penn State's going to win. And then, nice try.
I don't want to go down a rabbit hole, but, like, it's shocking to me that a coach of James Franklin level just got a 10-year extension prior to this season. Like, it makes absolutely no sense. I mean, the guy is literally, like, 3-18 versus ranked opponents. Like, it's terrible.
Yeah. That game definitely was... the biggest takeaway, though, that I had is that, yeah, the offense are... The defense is so good on that team.
Yeah.
That they should have won, had their offense done anything.
Yeah.
And it's frustrating to see because not that I necessarily thought that they'd beat Ohio State, but I thought that this was the best chance they've had in years to beat Ohio State.
It was.
And the fact that the defense played to the level that I thought they were going to, and the offense did nothing, was the most disappointing thing. Going back to the Chiefs game, the biggest takeaway that I had was one of the reasons that Mahomes plays so well is that they now have figured out who their number one receiver is. Yep. It's Rashee Rice.
Yeah.
He had the most targets. He was third in yards, second wide receiver. We also had a touchdown. And the biggest reason that Valdes-Scantley had more yards is that one catch that he had.
Mm-hmm.
So if you take that away, Rice is by far, in my opinion, the number one receiver on the team. So now that Mahomes has figured out who to go to in certain situations between Kelce, Rice, Pacheco, that's going to make the team so much more dangerous.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We could finish on the Eagles-Dolphins game and then very quickly cover the NBA because I want to watch the rest of the Phillies game. Mm-hmm. But so I thought the Dolphins were going to come in and beat us wearing Kelly Green, but they didn't. I am a little nervous on Hurts because he's on pace to blow Dak's interceptions from last year out of the water because, like, he's on pace to average, like, 24 picks for the season, which is insane.
Yeah.
But, like, the run game was great. A.J. Brown is a monster.
Uh-huh.
The defense held their own against one of the most dynamic offenses in the league.
Yeah.
And Tua kind of shrunk in key moments in the game.
Yeah.
And how many games? It's like 396 games since the Dolphins beat a above 500 record team.
Yeah.
So, like, we established that the Dolphins are, like, way better than the Bills, but they still don't look great against above 500 squads.
I hear you, but I don't know. I still think that they have things to look forward for. I think the defense played better than what the score said, like 31. I don't think they played that bad.
No.
But they weren't good necessarily, but they showed some flashes. Like, I like their pass rush. Their pass rush is really good. They need to get healthy. They're missing Xavier Howard. And, like, David Long Jr. got injured mid-game.
Yeah.
But other than that, I mean, I think they have a lot to look forward to for the season. Like, it's a long year, and like I said earlier, like, it's okay to have a hiccup like that against the Eagles. I think people are making a little too much out of the record above 500 thing. Like, what happens when they play the Bills? They lost to the Bills this year. They got blown out. But, like, think about last year when they played Buffalo and they beat them. Weren't they 1-1 or 2-2 maybe?
Well, like, they had to have been.
Yeah, right. So it's like, that's so BS.
You know?
Like, it's kind of BS. Like, and so I think the Dolphins are fine. I think they're sitting fine right now.
Well, this is what I said, though, is that what happened when the Dolphins play a physical team and they lost?
Yeah.
And that's the thing. I don't think there's a whole lot of other physical teams in the AFC. I think the Ravens are one of them, so maybe they'll struggle against them if they face them in the playoffs. But I think that this offense can go toe-to-toe with the Chiefs. I think they can go toe-to-toe with Jacksonville. I think they're better than Jacksonville, obviously. But I'm just saying, with, like, high-powered offenses, they can outmatch Jacksonville, who just doesn't have a physical team to me. But if you play the Eagles, if you play the 49ers in the Super Bowl, I don't know if you have the physicality to beat a team like that. And that's what I said last week, and it proves true to me, that's what I need to see from them.
I would throw Detroit in there, too.
What's that?
I would throw Detroit in there, too.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Detroit, to me, has slipped a little bit just because of the Ravens loss. But, yeah, they're right up there as well. So, if you throw in any of those three teams when it comes to physicality, I just don't know the Dolphins can pull it off. But, obviously, there's still a lot of season left. Maybe they trade for a guy in free agent, or with the trade deadline coming up, try to get a more physical defensive piece. But... Mm. I'm not worried about the Dolphins. I'm just saying that you have to think that far ahead, especially after a loss like this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We can move into the NBA really quickly. So the only game that has happened right now is Denver versus the Lakers, and Denver won by 12. It's crazy to me because Nikola Jokic had almost a 30-point triple-double, and I know he didn't touch a basketball all summer, too. Yeah, so, like... That's insane. They look like they didn't miss a beat on their short off season. LeBron at 21, 5-8. The bench did not give him any production, really. They had 20 bench points through three players, and they went like 8-9 guys on the bench. Uh-huh. So,
yeah,
they have a lot of ground to cover, but Denver looks like a front runner still, they will be. I think the Lakers will pick it up. I think it'll be between them, Golden State, and Phoenix. But you move eastward, it's three teams for me. And I'm surprised I'm throwing in the Heat because of the acquisitions that the Bucks and the Celtics made. But I think we could chalk this season down to seven teams winning the championship.
I could see it, yeah. And it's great. Nikola Jokic is such a baller. Like, he's just so good at basketball. He's not incredibly athletic or whatnot. Like, everyone wants to harp on that. It's like, dude, the dude is just a baller. Like,
I would say he is athletic, too. Did you see? I know it was in preseason, but, like, lost his dribble, 1 foot hop step back from mid-range. Like, he's athletic. It's just he doesn't look it.
Yeah.
Like,
when he's moving, you're like, he looks out of control almost. Yeah. Like, because he's so big and gorky and, like, just weird looking. But he's in control at all times. He knows exactly what he's doing. He's smart with the basketball. He has great touch on the jumper. He's has great feel and vision for players around him. They play insanely well together. Like, I think that's the biggest thing. It's like, they're not overly talented necessarily. Like, they do have the best player in the league, but they don't blow you away with talent. They blow you away because they play the best basketball of five guys in the NBA.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? They just play incredible. They look like when you'd go through the AAU circuit in high school, like you played the teams that you could tell like just got formed, like ratty ass jerseys, pennies basically. And then you were playing the teams that have literally been playing with each other for like 6 years. And that's what they look like. They just look like a well-oiled machine that blows you out by 50. In an AAU circuit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's, you know, that's what they look like. And it's like, that's such a good brand.
Yeah. Centers are just very athletic today, too. Like, I harp on Joel Embiid all the time. And from the screen, like, I don't understand how guys fall for his, like, pump fake from the perimeter.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, if I was on that, I'm falling for it, too. Like, he wouldn't even have to knock me down. Like, he could get me, like, straight off the pump fake.
Yeah.
And, like, Carl's very athletic, even though guys harp on him all the time. DeAndre Ayton even, too. Like, he could get up. Like, we have very athletic centers, and I think it goes underappreciated because all but one have, like, playoff success.
Yeah.
And, like, the league is stacked with talent. It's just, I feel like guys harp on NBA players because, like, a lot of them don't have, like, the same heart as, like, the guys from the earlier generations. But, like, maybe it's there, but, like, they're more focused on money and business than, like, ever before.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, my biggest... takeaway from this game is that LeBron's 38 years old and still scoring 20 points easily.
Yeah.
That's just insane.
Pretty effortlessly, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like, I just can't remember a player that played this late in his career and still looked this good.
And how many minutes did he play?
29.
Yeah.
10 for 16 shooting.
Play the last quarter, basically, and still put up that. So, I mean, he's just a freak of nature. And we're probably never going to see a basketball player like that. At least for a while, if we ever see one like that ever again.
Yeah.
So, just appreciating how great he is and what he just keeps continuing to do. And I really do think he could play until he's 40 or 41, if he wants to.
to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the key, if he wants to.
Yeah.
Are you guys looking for anything this season in particular?
I just want to see if the East is any more competitive than we think it's going to be. Like you said, it's down to three teams. I agree with that. I'm really just looking at the Bucks and Celtics, maybe the Heat, but those are the two teams I'm looking at. I want to see if there's other teams that maybe step up. The Knicks looked much better last year than the year before. Maybe they'll keep continuing that. Maybe the Sixers have some sort of breakthrough. I doubt it, but we'll see. And yeah, I'm interested to see if the Heat can run it back again. But that's just the biggest thing that I'm looking for this season.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to focus in on a single team. I'll do two. I'm really excited to see Oklahoma City and San Antonio this year.
Yeah.
I'm really, really, really excited. Like, even outside for the Spurs, even outside of Wembanyama, like, I'm ready to see guys like Devin Vassell take a leap.
Yeah.
Sohan take a leap. I'm drawing a blank on the name right now, which is kind of annoying.
The other guard?
Number three. Johnson, right?
Oh, yeah, Keldon Johnson.
Johnson. I couldn't think of the first name. I was going to say Keon, but no. But, yeah, I'm excited to see that. And, like, I like Popovich saying that Jeremy Sohan is moving to the point guard. I love that move. He doesn't have a jumper, really. I mean, it's like he's good from the mid-range, but he's not really a threat from three, which is, like, I'm getting PTSD from Ben Simmons because I was so high on Ben Simmons playing point guard.
Yeah.
And I'm very, very high on Jeremy Sohan playing point guard. But I think this guy's a little different. I think the mentality's different. I think his style of play is different. I think Ben was flashy. Jeremy Sohan is gritty, and he likes to get his nose dirty. So I'm ready to see that. I'm ready to see OKC. I love Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. He's a superstar. He's knocking on the door of top five if he's not already there.
I forget who, but someone on ESPN put him top eight.
Yeah, I love that. Yeah. I think I would put him around seven or six, maybe. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm ready to see him. I'm ready to see Chet Holmgren. Obviously, I was very high on Chet. It seems like he's polarizing as hell. Like, people are either one way or the other on him.
Mm-hmm. I never really look at preseason, but I thought that matchup versus the Thunder and the Spurs was really telling because everyone's very high on Wembanyama for good reasons, but like Chet outplayed him in four less minutes. And I really think he could be just as good as when people think Wembanyama is going to be.
Yeah.
And you got Josh Giddey, who's amazing, amazing passer. And you got Shai, who's a superstar, like you said. So I'm really looking forward to see the Thunder. I'm also really looking forward to see the Nets. Mm-hmm. I think Ben Simmons, I don't think he'll return to an all-star form this year, but I think he will have a good year.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what that means yet, but we'll see.
Well, I think anything would be better. Like, I think anything that warrants him playing like 65 games is like just better. Like, even if he averages 0 points, I mean, you played, and like, that's a step in the right direction. And like the thing is, people harp on Ben Simmons all the time, and like, I actually hear your point. It's like, he won't be an all-star, but he still has value. Like, you know what I'm saying? And like, obviously on his contract right now, like, that's a different story. But like, for him right now, it's just, dude, get on the court and do something for me. Like, he's a defensive threat. Like, he's 6'10 with like a 7 foot wingspan. I mean, he's a threat already on defense, no matter what.
Yeah.
So, like, if he just goes out there and puts effort in and is, like, I feel like just playing at a little bit diminished role, especially for offense, like, that's where I think the Nets could benefit from him.
Yeah, they could build a culture like they did in 2018 with that team, I feel like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see it.
You guys have anything else?
No, I'm good.
Okay, let's watch the Phillies. All right, we'll see you next week.